let me finally come to India-Saudi-Pakistan triangle, that relationship. Now, you've, I think, pointed out quite convincingly that Saudi's understanding of the Jammu and Kashmir dispute changed fundamentally once in 2001, and then changed perhaps more fundamentally in 2008. Those are all key events. But specifically from the prism of Saudi-Pakistan relationship, the Saudi-Pakistan relationship, do you think that's reached some sort of a breaking point, especially after Pakistan refused, as it had done perhaps before, to provide defense equipment, technical assistance, forces on the ground? It refused to do that in the Yemenis war. Do you think now that's a definitive break in the Saudi-Pakistan relationship? And what does that mean for us moving forward?
First, we have to understand Saudi-Pakistan relations. They are qualitatively different from Saudi-India relations. In fact, you could call them two parallel tracks. So when Prince Saud, earlier they were not parallel tracks. Earlier, till the Cold War and a little beyond, Saudi-Pakistan relations were the substantial political and defense relationship. India was not part of that. Then with Jaswant Singh's visit over the 10 year of the first decade, you find that parallel tracks are created. And I believe they still are there on the ground. They're parallel tracks. The Saudi-Pakistan relationship is an asymmetrical relationship. Pakistan, it was created in the years of the Cold War, and therefore has given Pakistan a significant place in the defense and security scenario of the kingdom and indeed of the region. But don't forget, it's not on its own. It's in alliance with Pakistan. The triangle that you should be looking at is United States, Pakistan, Saudi Arabia. This has been the continuing triangular relationship. Saudi Arabia and Pakistan were the bastions of U.S. interest in the region, which ended only with the 9/11 events. Since then, Saudi Arabia became a matter of concern. Saudi Arabia sees Pakistan as a security provider within the country. Initially, this was true of the rest of the Gulf also, but those countries are so little, the American umbrella is good enough for them. With the case of Saudi Arabia, they were not able to have, it's a huge country, two-thirds the size of India. It could not have Americans posted in different places for domestic reasons. As you know, when the American soldiers came in the context of the first Gulf War, there was a huge dissident movement within the country, whose reverberations are still there, albeit muted, but they are still there. In the case of, so Saudi Arabia doesn't have, so it brings in Pakistanis. From 1968 to 88, when the Saudi army was still being fashioned, Pakistani troops, there was 25,000 Pakistani troops were located at the Iraq border, Jordan border, and the Yemen border. In 1988, they were unceremoniously removed from the kingdom. There's a complex story there, and I'll quickly mention it, that Saudi-Iran relations had deteriorated in 87. Large numbers of Iranian pilgrims had been killed in a stampede, police firing. There was a fear that they would attack the Haram Sharif and plaster it with pictures of Ayatollah Khomeini. We don't know if it's true or not, but the fact is that the ill-trained Saudi police and security personnel shot blindly into the demonstrators, and all told about 1,200 people were killed, some with bullet wounds and some due to stampede. So there was the relationship had deteriorated. Do recall that this is the time when the Iran-Iraq war is still going on. And it is in the midst of that you have this calamity. So Saudi Arabia truly believed that a war was imminent and asked Ziaul Haq to do three things. Number one, not to send Shia soldiers to Saudi Arabia. Number two, to purge the Pak army of Shia. And number three, in case of a war with Iran, to join Saudi Arabia against Iran. I point out to you that a sycophant like Ziaul-Haq could not agree to any one of these. Pakistan has 20% Shia population. And in the as Pakistan was involved with the jihad, etc., the divide, the sectarian divide has increased and there's a lot of conflict. But no Pakistani leader, however sycophantic he might be vis-a-vis Saudi Arabia, can join in a sectarian conflict. So there was no way he could agree to any one of these. And I was told at those days that Saudi Arabia, Pakistan may have had as many as 30% of its soldiers from the Shia community. See, these things are not known. They're just impressions people tell you in the drawing room. So the fact is, it's a big number. So these soldiers were removed in a 3-month period. Every one of them was removed. So, but that doesn't mean the relationship became zero. So, Pakistani technicians, particularly for the Air Force, pilots for training and to service the aircraft, the American aircraft, same aircraft in Pakistan, they used to be there. 2009, you have the Saudi forces having a skirmish with the Houthis in Yemen. Ali Abdullah Saleh, between 2006 and 10, launched six assaults on the Houthis. All of them failed. In one case, the Saudis decided to combat the Houthis themselves. And 400 Saudi soldiers were killed. It's a calamity. And there was panic in Riyadh. When they had this panic, they asked Pakistan to provide a battalion. And a battalion was sent to the Saudi-Yemen border. Not exactly at the border, a little away for moral reasons. It's still there.
Okay.
Since then, it has become, I think, a division. We don't know whether it's a brigade or a division. It doesn't matter. The fact is that it is there. That's number one. Second thing, the point that you noted just now, in 2015, you have the new king and you have a crown prince, and the crown prince is not yet a crown prince, he becomes a crown prince 2 years later. But at that time, he's defense minister. He launches the assault upon Yemen. And he makes the mistake that many other idiots before him have made. And that is short, sharp conflict. I will launch a short, sharp conflict. In 3 months, they will be on their knees. And I will be then able to manage the politics. Saddam Hussein thought this would happen when he attacked Iran. And the Saudis thought this would happen when they attacked Yemen. He didn't. Even now, 5 years later, we still have the war. Paid a very heavy price, 100,000 Yemeni dead. At that time, Saudi Arabia asked Pakistan to send soldiers in the Yemen conflict. Clearly a sectarian conflict, because the whole business of fighting with the Houthis is that they are Zaydi and therefore Shia, and therefore the outreach platform for the Iranians. So this is the background. So Pakistan refused. I had known that. I had said here in India that Pakistan can never accept that for the same reasons that Ziaul-Haq turned it down in 88. Situation has not changed. How can Pakistani soldiers fight the Houthis purely on sectarian basis, killing Shia? I mean, they also have a country to run at home, however badly. So they refused. And the Saudis, because of the asymmetrical relationship, what does Saudi do for Pakistan in return? It keeps Pakistan afloat. It has been providing them with oil, free oil. We call it credit. What happens is that every few years they write off the credit. So it becomes free supply of oil, massive investments in the country, and massive development and industrialization in the country. So Pakistan is kept solvent to a large extent and functional to a large extent because of Saudi largesse. And Saudi alongside, you get UAE also coming in with some dollops of cash. So it is in this sort. The Saudis truly believed, as did the UAE, that they are people who should do what we tell them to do. Because we keep them solvent, we keep them functional, we keep them afloat. This is the mindset. There is no sensitivity about the other. That, you know, look, he also has issues. Don't ask him to do something which will harm his own national ethos. But there was no such understanding. The UAE Minister of State called Pakistan ungrateful. So this was the background. But they attempted to cover it up, and a reasonable working relationship was put in place. But this is the background. And already there was a little bit of a murmur. What happened just now shows how dysfunctional Pakistan is. And what an incompetent government Pakistan actually has. If there's one government that is competing with India in being thoroughly incompetent and dysfunctional, our neighbor would, I think, would get the gold medal against our silver medal. The Pakistanis have this extraordinary situation of wanting to highlight the Kashmir issue. You should also read the mood, just as you want the others to be sensitive to you. They don't want to do that. They want to move on. The Kashmir issue doesn't resonate with them. Look at the scenario in the Gulf. You have this competition with Iran. You have a war in Yemen. You have a war in Syria. You have competition in Iraq. You have these wretched Americans creating a tanker warfare right in your midst. You have serious issues right at your doorstep, and the threat of conflict on a daily basis, and an ongoing conflict right there in Yemen as well as in Syria. The Pakistani, we want a UN special session for domestic reasons. Now, let us be very objective here. I don't think any Pakistani has sleepless nights on an OIC session coming and passing a stupid resolution on Jammu and Kashmir. They have passed resolutions from 1990. We used to take them seriously initially. Foreign Minister Jaswant Singh told me, I was the Joint Secretary, these resolutions are not worth the paper they are written on. We will ignore them in future. And from that day till today, we ignore them because they are not worth. And he's absolutely right. There are reams and reams of resolutions passed. Some of them are not even introduced in the OIC. Most countries don't even know that they have approved them. They are, when we go and ask them, why did you pass this? They said, we didn't even know about it. Our national, they do not reflect our national position. Our national position is articulated by our foreign minister and the foreign office. Therefore, do not attach any importance to them. The members themselves tell us. I've heard this directly. I've heard this at the OIC office. As you know, the Indian ambassador in Riyadh informally has meetings with Secretary General of OIC. So I've had those meetings. And just to exchange notes, that's all. Secretary General himself told me, don't attach any value to them. They are worth nothing. But Pakistan attaches a lot of importance to them. Anyway, they did at this time. They wanted a special session. So they wanted this conclave of Muslim countries to gather. And Saudi Arabia didn't think this was the right time or the right issue. Be that as it may, they did not. They allowed the Secretary General to issue a statement. So there's some OIC statement already there. But Pakistan wanted more. They wanted a proper gathering where there would be cameras and everyone would say this country and that it would add to the, they thought add to the credibility. When Saudi Arabia refused, the foreign minister, whose extraordinary outburst, said that they will turn to other Muslim countries who are more sensitive to them, to their concerns.
This is Mr. Qureshi.
Shah Mahmood Qureshi. Public statement in this guy. You are making this statement in respect to a country that sustains you, that saves you from bankruptcy, that gives you oil free of charge and has done so for more than 20 years. Are you such an idiot? I couldn't believe it. He made this statement. Saudi Arabia said, we have given you $3 billion, returned $1 billion straight away. Oil credits are stopped. Why? You know that there is a divide in the Muslim world today. Iran, of course, is already a problem for you. But a new problem has emerged in the shape of Turkey. Turkey is challenging Saudi Arabia directly in terms of leadership of the Muslim world, both in doctrinal terms and in political terms. They say these chaps are Wahhabi. They support extremism. We are Hanafi and Sufi. So doctrinal competition a political competition that we are a moderate country, we are a strong country. Look at his outreach. He's got armed forces in Iraq, he's out forces in Syria, and he's now reached up across to Libya and is challenging the Greeks and the Cypriots and the Israelis in the East Mediterranean. This is the kind of great leader, the Ottoman reincarnation. That's what... There is a problem. Do you ever tell your best friend that there is the guy whom he hates, who's your his rival, is going, that you'll turn to him? This is what here. So you add Iran to that, add Turkey to that, and then you add Qatar. Qatar is already a beleaguered. So this was the greatest mistake. Now, your question is, what does it all mean for us? I personally feel that this is a mild rupture. Short-term rupture. It will be repaired. I also point out to you, the relationship has nothing to do with the politicians who rule Pakistan. You've had a motley group, Zardari, and Nawaz Sharif, and Benazir, and Imran Khan. The relationship is with the armed forces. The relationship. Pakistan's relationship with Saudi Arabia and United States is Pentagon and CIA. There. And here, intelligence and armed forces. That is, it has nothing to do with who rules the country at that moment. It's irrelevant. Even with regard to the United States relationship with Pakistan, it supersedes the man in the White House. Because it is the Pentagon that assesses the value of the relationship at that time. So I have a feeling that there will be some recovery of the relationship.
Right.
Now what Mahmoud Qureshi did was he rushed to China. Now, if I were to sit back, I would comment on 3 points. Number one, that yes, there is an emerging divide in the Muslim world, and that is the crucial competition that we should follow. If Turkey as a principal role player, Iran, of course, beleaguered, sanctions driven, but Iran is very anxious to retain its ties with Turkey. And you have Qatar, of course, as an engine of funding, whatever, but it's ideologically devoted to political Islam. All three are devoted to political Islam, and two of them linked to the Muslim Brotherhood, and hence their outreach in Libya. So you have that, the burgeoning divide.
Yes.
Second aspect is the Pakistan outreach to China at a time of great national crisis. It is affirming a certain relationship, but in time of crisis, and China has come forward. The third aspect is what I mentioned earlier, that you are looking at an emerging order, regional order, that brings in, embraces Russia, China, Iran, and Pakistan. The only one who is still sitting it out, but keep an eye on that, it is Turkey. Turkey wants to, at this stage, not make choices. As they use a crude cliche, run with the hare, hunt with the hound, they still want to retain the link with the United States. But my personal sense is Turkey's strategic partnership is with Moscow. With Washington, it is with a personal relationship with Donald Trump. It has certain value, and Donald Trump has done certain things to advantage Turkey, particularly in Northeast Syria, but it is not something you can count on forever. Pentagon is very unhappy with the Turks in terms of their bilateral, their military ties with Russia and the purchase of the S-400 missile system.
Yes.
So you have, I would keep an eye there, but if I were to sit back and write an academic paper, I would look at the map and point out to anyone who wishes to listen in New Delhi that you're looking at an emerging regional order that is extremely dangerous for our long-term interests.
All right. Thank you so much, Ambassador, for your time and your insights. That brings us to the end of our interview. For our viewers, we will attach links to the Ambassador's works in the article so you can have a look at them there. And thank you, everyone, for your time. Thank you.
Thank you.